welcome Professor Jim Niles.
Midwest at all is somewhat out here, literally, right? wrong person, the wrong role, and our managers in some cases may make jagging on citation from time to time, take on things. So that's a little slightly different in special in school. As you know, there is a very recently, a few minutes ago, there's no commercial use of UAVs. Given that model right, where they don't have and Europe's the one they are at, are probably attached. We have been operating under the CRMA process, which is available to the public agencies. And as a certain government agency, as part of the university, that was an option that was available to us. It was not very easily and linearly available to us. We actually had to go through a process involving the Attorney General of the State of California. We had to untangle the fact that the regents of the University of California are not really part of the State of California government. So we actually got into a process by which that had to be sorted out. So the FAA really looked critically at the really important agency. Let's figure out constitutionally where the University of California fits in the State of California. That was the whole discussion. Our current next project, our new project, is under the CRA that's issued to us in UC Davis for all the management. Just a little bit of, and again, you're probably very familiar with this, the rules of which we operate. They have both the pilot and observer. Typically, that's what I'm doing. And we'll commercialize, so we pass the novelties now. We can't really remember anything from it, but we passed it a long time ago. We have class 2 medicals, and all processes that we've shared to get involved. We do find models, typically in Brooklyn, Brooklyn Center, 48 hours before a flight, that was commissioned by our COA, and we actually call that the city of all air traffic control, again, commissioned by our COA. We tell them when we're out and tell them when we're done. Their interest is usually about zero. They want to know why we're bothering them. I said, well, because we have 43 page document from your boss and such. It was usually a very rosy chat. They try to hear from us now. The CRA, as you know, limits you to geographically limited area, a particular type of operation, line of sight, VFR, all our operational areas are 5,000 miles from any airport we can find in sections. Interesting discussions as part of our CMA process. We asked if we could go out and strike, and FAA said the dropping of off is for you. With some of our actual strike. And they said, well, Professor Jones, what part of the dropping of off is do you not understand? We dealt with that a little bit, and they said, can you do a safety analysis for us? And me and Bruce Engineer recommended a safety analysis, and actually it took, I knew the drop size we were releasing, I knew the drop velocity of those droplets, and actually calculated how likely we would be damaged by the impact of those droplets. And then for a good toxicological comparison, I compared that to a 50-year expected thunderstorm intensity. And now in California. So we actually show that if the hazard of someone under the spray was roughly equivalent to running to their car from a shopping mall down the road during a rainstorm. And then they said, good job, keep up good work. So I think it showed that the process is trackable. And in fact, we really did have a good safety analysis of the hazard of spraying the road. Unfortunately, we can only at this time spray the water. And in fact, that's the drinking quality water. So we're going to get a new bottle of aerated water and put it in the aircraft for the spring. That, fortunately, that does work with some of the evaluations that we're doing. We currently have two operational areas in California, two COAs, one for Anaheim, California, specifically Oakville area, and one for a place called Los Angeles down in Central Valley. So we're looking at two types of special jobs. Very different geographic areas, very different from if you're not familiar with AirMax, it's a very substantial aircraft, about 100 kilograms. Looks like a small helicopter. Liquid-cooled engine. If you, like me as a child, aspire to a Yamaha 250 when you were a teenager, flying gas engine is was in sort of rather low control, and it was, yeah, it's the traditional hot-top footprint, and often a limitation to the traditional hot-top, but also some of the influence too. One of the issues was we have sort of a 16-liter liquid capacity, and I want to distinguish the fertilizing, spraying, and seeding operations and evidence for how different that is from inspection operations. Fundamentally, despite what we have with data management and all the new areas of agriculture community, it's fundamentally a lot of materials handling. It's literally tons of hot inputs going in, fertilizer and liquid applications, so tons of air going in, and we're harvesting tons of spring air, tons of spring air coming out. So for these operations to pay on the aircraft, it's very important. Then we're going to weight balance and all the other issues of sort of real aircraft kinds of things. So I think when we look at agriculture, we do have sort of inspection and data side of it, but when we start gathering or fertilizing and spraying, we've got the materials in there. There has to be a payload that's significant for this to make sense in commercial sense. Some areas of my specialty jobs, it's going to be very, for that area that I mentioned about materials handling, it's going to be very hard to compete in some crops with manned aircraft for aerial application. The economies of scale are very significant. The infrastructure that's built up around crop listing is significant, and the productivity is of course significant, and the cost is relatively low. So it's going to be difficult to displace a turbine powered air tractor going out in some crops. Rice in California is big, it's flat. They need a lot of tons out very quickly. That's going to be a difficult commercial deal. When we get into the specialty crops, a couple things change. First off, the value of the application per hectare goes up significantly. The land areas change. This is a typical area where we've been operating since our Oakville. This is a 50-foot contour of the mountains on the scale here. We have 45-degree slopes, and we have 2 to 3 acre, one hectare type of lots of grapes, or lots of lettuce, or whatever the specialty crop is. So we're getting into a place where it's really not easy to do from the area because of the shape, the size, and the topography. It also is challenging to do the ground extents of the ground areas. We have limited access, ground-based access during the process of the season. Often a spring application goes in the winter time when we have rainstorms, and we start to soil compaction when we go in, but also just the handling of the vehicles danger to the outdoors. So there are times of year when it is difficult to get in. Other crops have been irrigated. Once the crop is sort of closed up, what we call late on time, ground equipment's not going in anymore. There's no access to drive over the crop. So there are times in which there are very limited access. These are permanent landings, orchards and vineyards. We can map them, we know them. For one of the photos I'll show you in a moment, everybody has been identifying that as an opportunity to serve. High value and lots of spray applications come out. Now, I'm going to touch a little bit earlier about reducing the amount of spraying, why we spray everything, why we still not spray without a problem. And the viewpoint there is exactly right. The risk of a crop, total crop loss is very expensive. And you can almost think of it as a vaccine. And then what we can wait and see, if you get malaria, we can get an antimalarial pill before you go to the tropics. Most of us say, well, I'm going to follow them out of it. I'm going to wait and come home and see if I get malaria. The farmers like that too. And then some of the problems, by the time the treatment would be on top of this. So that's why I'm sometimes just spraying and it seems like it's not doing enough. Back in the area, this is one of the areas that we've been operating. Premium production area, this nice view of some of the areas that we're actually on. To come in around here, you can see it's a little bit treacherous and slow and it's expensive. So this is where the actually has the fiber edges. I think if I push the button here, it might see. You can return to the old quick clip of the aircraft. So forward.
Is that the video?
No, so it has. Any questions? Okay, no, actually I have a whole lot of resolution. Okay, cool. Sorry about that. Anyway, you can go to our website and see our operation. Sorry for the video. How do we evaluate this technology? Well, we, for the first stage of this project, early on the project, we said, let's look at what the customer might ask about, the person in charge of the going away for the technical service. Let's assume that we have the operation. What about the spray position that we get? And what about productivity? It's ultimately the real question is, does it treat the product the same way that my existing medicine treats it? And is it more productive than a ground-based common form cut? How much will it cost? So a key parameter that we look at is the application rate that is possible. The liters per hectare that we can find on the spray. Remember, we don't spray water and it strikes the target area. And also, how much liquid can we apply as what comes out of the aircraft? And I'll talk a little bit about the entire other regulatory side of pesticides. We have our aircraft regulation. When we start spraying things, we also get the EPA involved. And the FDA would follow a certain aspect of spraying toxic materials. So we're going to look at evaluating this particular vehicle. Remember, we're going to spray water. So our sample medium was a water-sensitive vehicle. So we actually had to manipulate where the water droplets to account for the fact that we're going to spray water and not an active ingredient or a tracer, as we often do. Locations within the county and on the ground, and we just have a standard technique to effectively do image analysis to look at this car and analyze how much spray material is on that car. These are very common techniques in spray work in agriculture. So within the county, this is sort of our early main work. You can see the roads are getting developed. These dry testing papers were placed in the canopy, some on leaves, some on the canes, you actually had some on the ground. So that's how we collected the spray. Monitoring the aircraft, we had a block at Oakville Fill Station, which is UC property. We had four of them now viewing cameras in the aircraft. That allowed us to ground speed directly, actually see the area that we were spraying, have a complete record of every spray mission. From that, we do a direct measurement of how much area we sprayed, and we could weigh and plyometrically measure the liquid in the tanks before and after spraying. So we have the direct measurements of the spray mission. We observe all times involved in the operation, spray time, zero back for refill time, all of the things that we're always interested in when looking at a new technology. And we always wonder what the meteorology is. These are our basic measurements that we do. And I'll show you one out in a moment. Due to the design of the aircraft and the fact that it came in as a commercial product, manufacturer was not interested in a lot of modifications to the spray system, which we cannot wait to do that. But right now, we're going with spray system and supply not in fact. So the only way for us to do vary the amount of liquid we're applying in land area per acre per hectare was by spraying sprays two or three times and spraying making the passes closer together, or what's called swath width for the application. That was how we could adjust the liquids per hectare that were actually applied to the vineyard in station. So I'll carry myself out. So what we can actually do is we made some swath widths, two row widths and some swath widths, three rows. The standard recommendation by the manufacturer, based on their training rice in Japan, was about three rows law from my past, and that's a 14 liters per gallon here. Not very heavy spray application. A typical ground-based application might be 1,000 liters per gallon, or 2,000 liters per gallon. So this is orders of magnitude here, as far as this spray compared to the ground spray. We could have it out by making multiple passes or shortening the swath that we can actually get up to around 30 to 40 units right here of an application rate. That is close to what a commercial man area application would be in our crops. So we are getting at the reasonable range of application rates for an area application, this is a man application. When we look at productivity, that is how fast, how does this compare to a ground vehicle? How quickly can we get the job done? Obviously, as we make multiple passes on short roadways, we get about 2 hectares per hour work rate. This is still much faster than ground vehicles. This is probably twice to 3 times faster than ground vehicles. This is when the roadways begin to get interested. It's a fast application, a lot faster than some of the hillside applications. You can go much faster, but if you do go with sort of a very light application, you can get up to 4 or 5 hectares per hour. Very fast work rate from people from the shipping districts. What about the deposition that we actually got in canopy? The way the process of paper works, this is how it looks pre-spray. After the aircraft goes over and spray material strikes the cards, this is how the card looks. So you literally get a capture of droplets on cards. This card can be scanned in with image analysis, and we can estimate the volume of liquid discharge of the card. That is the primary response for that we got. This is then, when we scan it, is using a drop vision NAC. That's a commercial product that's been fairly well accepted, especially by the regulatory folks. And we can actually get a guidance breaker or a percent coverage of spray material card. So that's not much of an impossible. When we looked at what we actually got from that position, not surprisingly, the more time you spend spraying, shorter road swaths, more passes, the higher deposition that we get. We actually got about 46 liters per hectare average on the product. And variabilities are very high in spraying. You see some cars that are still yellow, you see some cars that are very blue. That is true of everything spray application, right? A lot of variability in ag spray. When we look at this graphically, we see not surprisingly, as you increase the application rate, you get more deposition. We have a lot of variability, we have some outliers. It would trim those out, this relationship tightens up a little bit. So this is the type of information we take to a grower, and we say, okay, what kind of deposition do you need for this particular pesticide that you're spraying? And then we can look down and see, how do we fly it? Do we fly 2 passes? Do we fly 3 road swaths, 2 road swaths? This is kind of operational information that we need to see whether there's even an economic case for this vehicle inside the spray. So we turned it around and we looked at spray deposition versus the work rate. That is, if you need to spray 4 hectares per hour, this is probably the deposition that you can expect.
We're using the battery here.
So there's clearly a relationship in that as you go faster, they expect the spray deposition to go down. Now, there's another aspect. To begin to use the UAV for pesticide spraying, and that's the regulatory side of it. The FAA looks at the vehicle itself is actually 137, which is ag operations, defines really what you need to do in addition to your aviation side to be spraying the pesticide. Also, EPA, California, and federal EPA is very concerned about spraying. And for us to understand spray drift from this very new vehicle, if we were going in with a vehicle that looked like an air tracker or a Cessna Agamemnon, very commonly used aircraft, then the EPA has a sense of the type of spray drift that is moving off site that you get from that vehicle. When you go on something like the RX, no one really knows. So what we did was we
created some non-campus spraying. We put a line of spray cards out, and we flew the aircraft over the line of spray cards to get a sense of what's the movement of the material from the aircraft. It's commonly called a SWOT test in the trade. So we had cards placed out. We went plus or minus 8 meters outward from the center of the aircraft. Sort of typical operations here. For 3 meters over the target, almost all our spraying was about 20 feet or below. 20 feet or below typically would be at maybe 10 or 15 feet above the target. So it's all of those stuff. We measured winds, we made a number of applications. So we've got a lot of data on the swap of the aircraft. This is typically what you would see. Aircraft flies. In this case, it's flying from you through the screen away from us. We measured the spray deposit as it flew along the center line. And you see that there is a reasonable swath width here. The manufacturer said about 7.5 meters. That's about what we have. And you see that it drops off very quickly. So what we can do, by taking this swath, we can then use the standard regulatory model, which is called ACTS. EPA, federal and state, uses ACTS, short for agricultural dispersion, as a Lagrangian-based model for predicting how much spray drift on an application site. So we said, eventually, any vehicle that's spraying by air will have to go through some regulatory process for spray drift. So let's look at ACTS for how this particular vehicle, our Max, might fit in. Well, it doesn't. All our data for ACTS, the smallest thing that we could find was a Robinson R22. So all their validating data and all of the mathematics were limited to a fairly large, fairly powerful aircraft. Our river power is outside limits. The displacement between the river and the spray boat is outside limits. Our forward speed is too slow. The speed of the river is too high. And the weight of the aircraft is way too low. So we're very much pushing our regulatory model limit here. Nonetheless, like everyone else in the world, we click that we accept that we're using the model outside limits, and we look at the position and actually see, does the model give us anything reasonable for this aircraft? And this is a lot of the spray deposition and functional swath fit. We were on 20,000 grams of material, and at 7.5 meter swath fit, it actually looks kind of reasonable. So the model is not really going crazy on this, although it's like guaranteed to work, it's still giving us numbers. Could we go out and take out? We're getting reasonable numbers. And when we look at deposition, a profile, this profile actually looks like a swath width of a saw somewhat. So there's hope for the regulatory model. So our conclusions were, it's a feasible spraying alternative to manned aerial application. Also, it's a feasible alternative to ground-based application. The platform that we tested, it is a low volume, remember, sort of 20 liters per hectare instead of 2,000. It's a low volume, small droplet size application. If we want to increase the volume of the water per hectare, that is challenging, and it cuts into the productivity rates. Primarily because you have to lay on the model to reload those 16-liter tanks. So we hit the limits and they load very quickly. The flight and vehicle parameters are currently outside the standard regulatory model. So where are we going in the future with this? We're going to be spraying out ingredients. We have a COA application in for that. With those type of ingredients, we can do directly the city dust control test. Do we kill insects to reprotect against fungus by spraying the consumer? We'll do field measurements of off-site drift. We think it'll be less than the main aircraft. Based on those data, we can develop a business case and look at the economics. The manufacturer has a pretty big error bar around what they consider to be the price of the aircraft, or the operating cost of the aircraft. We do know it's about $100,000, somewhere in that range, for the $1,000 line. So we got $100 fixed cost, by the way, at best. And we are going to be on regulatory activities we can get an immersion into spray compression.
Public acceptance of it. I've been working for a lot of years in pesticide application. You develop a thick skin if you work in pesticide application in California. Working in the other pesticide application, you develop even a thicker skin. And I think that thicker skin is going to be useful for some of us as we take these technologies forward. We've really got to show that it is an environmental improvement. I think that's one bottom line. And I very much appreciate the opportunity to come and speak. This audience is about what we're going to do in agriculture. It's been very interesting to be here with those positions, too. Thanks.
We're running long.
But, you know, again, we've got these people in the room, and I'm going to say, does anybody have any questions? Maybe we can take a couple of questions.
You said that the EPA will be involved because of the use of pesticides. How do they feel about using a two-stroke engine?
The Air Resources Board will be looking at a two-stroke engine, of course. The EPA, the Office of Pesticide Programs, is less concerned about the vehicle other than how it affects the sprayer. So it's a different regulatory agency that's going to be used as a two-stroke engine.
So that would be something that kind of for review. It's
quite commercial. Right. Absolutely. Yes?
Some of the numbers, based on, like you said, the nice number of vehicles you're using right now, the number of comparing, seems to me that some of the newer UAV technologies would be able to deliver on dramatic orders of magnitude performance. When was autonomy and navigation and stuff? Can you talk a little bit about where you might see that going in terms of potential greater acceptance and pressure?
We would absolutely welcome any of those vehicles working with us in the program where we're looking at spray applications in agriculture. The reason that we're working with Yamaha's, they effectively came to us and said, we have a vehicle, we have a system that we'd like to look at in special products. So get our experience, especially for us. We'll look at it as we would any vehicle, whether it's a brand new or a base. I think you're exactly right. What our data are showing is that particular vehicle may be just fine for rice in Japan, but it's going to be challenging for special crops in California, especially given the fixed cost of the vehicle. I can assure you from the growing animals that we've seen in this vehicle, a better vehicle is going to get significantly more programs. So I can't go quickly enough new vehicles to come in and look at this. I think that's where the real opportunities we can have for vehicles, and I think the spray system on this is even more dinosaur than the vehicle. It's a 1950 spray system on here. We can look at better optimization of spray systems for the particular aerodynamics we have with different aircraft. It's tremendously exciting to us right now what's going to be possible with this. If we can get down and spray between the roads with some of these vehicles, it completely opens up a whole new opportunities for use of chemical use. Yeah. Fantastic question. Yeah, we're all about that. Yes,
Jerry, go ahead.
The bottom of the dog is split underneath leaves most of the time. Meaning the measurements to support that.
Compared to fixing the aircraft, like that's the rotary motion is the way more effective in the application. Yeah, and that's actually the industry is very much aware of the benefits of rotary application. And a lot of merchant growers now will go to higher cost with the rotary wing over the fixed wing because of that effect. We are within the band where you would see the commercial demand rotary wing aircraft operating, probably a little bit lower in some cases, but not dramatically lower. They don't get down to that. Our visual, what we see visually, and without tracer or pesticide in the tank, we can't take really any meaningful measurements. Because the water sensitivity to spray good is something about zero. So I'm limited. Visually, I think we can, the drift from this bigger vehicle is less than a ground operation. I think it probably is on the order of an aircraft. In some cases, it could be, I'm really going to talk about it here. It could be that because of the way that we don't have it down the launch to bring it down with manual ground. And this should be able to give us that information. And sorry for the brief answer.
Okay.
Lots.
One last one, Ted had one.
The first question is, why would you appeal like that? Can't we be spray infrastructure place on the ground? Say we would be infrastructure for your being there. Second question is, if you need more payload, you don't need production. Isn't that a bad R22?
Right. The question about moving and fix the infrastructure and spraying, there are folks looking at that. There's actually been a couple of systems put out there, and so far the economics of that have not worked out, both from the installation and the fact that what we've seen is people still, with a fixed system, have to attach the pump to each row. Because the pressure setting and the rate of delivery of the water is greater than what you might see for an irrigation system. So there's been a couple of mechanical reasons why the fixed, built-in infrastructure for spraying has not been an option. People are trying it, they're still trying it. No one's really been able to make it work yet. So we're going on to the Washington State now, and you look at it. And what you'll find in many cases with a manned aircraft, there's not enough demand for a manned aircraft in a certain ag production area, then you don't find applicators are there. So if you look at rice country in Central Valley, there are plenty of ag applicators there. You go over down and say, okay, I need an airline vision and ag. Someone's going to come in from somewhere else and help those vehicles. So there's a little like, tradition of all this there. So I hope that gets into that side of why there's not a manned system there.
Chris, do you have one?
If you can still get the volume that needs to go out, you know, whether that's done on a large vehicle, a single large vehicle, a high vehicle, or a number of smaller vehicles with a fairly high sort of payload to match ratio. And it's really that ratio, and it's really possible. So if you could do it with micro vehicles, but I think to the rover, then we don't care whether there's 50 little guys out there or one bigger guy. If you can get, say, 100 liters per hectare out there in a couple of hours, then they're not going to do it. You might be able to take it down by probably a third to 50% of the total volume. One of the other constraints that you run into is when you get on my pesticide, the other regulatory barrier is the pesticide label. And so what the label specifies is not only the amount of agrarian per hectare or per acre, but also the water pile in which that agrarian has to be diluted. And we have encouraged all the leading manufacturers to look first at chemicals that have a manned area, like that have already been, first off, proven to work with aerial application rates and also legal to be applied area. Because I think from a vendor standpoint, you say, well, I want to go in and I want to fight the battle of an unmanned aircraft. And then on top of that, say, I want to fight the battle to get a new pesticide label issue, is a pretty high barrier. Whereas to say, I'm going to find chemicals that work in manned aircraft, and I'm going to apply those chemicals in the same concentration and rate as the manned aircraft, at least for that first year, at least for that first 2 or 3 years, I don't have to find a chemical like that. And those are roughly equivalent to registering a new drug, in that there's toxicology data that's on working with that. So our recommendation to the European industry is find area levels that work, choose those chemicals, and get them. Good question on the last thing. your spa should be able to change that.
And that's where we're going to have to end it. Thank you, sir.